Recession, layoffs, ChatGPT, AI. It seems like this is the worst time to become a software developer. In this video, let's understand how there's a paradigm shift in how people program, how in the last 1 month, I've been using ChatGPT very effectively in my workflow as a senior engineer, and how you, irrespective of where you are right now, in college, still trying to learn how to code, or if you're currently an engineer yourself, how you can implement ChatGPT in your workflow to become a 10x engineer, and how this was never possible a month ago when ChatGPT did not exist. I'll also be talking a little bit around whether or not it'll take your jobs, what are the new jobs it'll create, and how you can seize the opportunity, and if you use ChatGPT effectively, how you can become a better engineer, and even if you have a low IQ, even if you've tried to code in the past and weren't able to, how you can now, using your personal tutor, become a 10x engineer. With that, let's get right into the video. I think ChatGPT, or generally AI helping people to code, is going to be a paradigm shift around how people used to code. A lot of things will become very easy, and a lot of new job opportunities will open up. A lot of old jobs will close away as well. And in this video, I'll show you what are the kind of jobs I feel will go away, and what are the kind of jobs that I feel will be built up. How it will become very easy to code nowadays. In fact, in the one past month, I have used ChatGPT extremely effectively to outsource a bunch of tasks that used to be manual tasks for me, which makes me feel it's basically given everyone an intern, which becomes super helpful, especially if you're trying to learn how to code, or if you're currently coding and you need someone to help out on a few things. So if you're just here for the answer of the question, whether or not ChatGPT will take our jobs, I think the answer is yes and no. It will take away some jobs, but it will create better jobs and will lead to a better humankind in the future. That's my belief, and I'm super bullish generally on engineering, coding, coders, and software developers. I do believe the number of jobs may go down, but the quality of jobs and the quality of engineers will go up, which is usually a big plus for humanity in general. Now comes the question of how I have implemented it in my own workflow. So I'll be taking three practical examples of things that used to take me some time in the past and now are much easier for me, and how I used to sort of write ugly code because I knew it'll take me time to clean it up, and how ChatGPT cleans it up for me. With that, let's actually start some coding now. I'm going to open ChatGPT on my machine, and let me show you the first place where ChatGPT helped me a lot. So the internet is filled with APIs. If you've seen my last video, the full stack roadmap, you understand how to create HTTP APIs of your own. There is a public repository here called public APIs, which gives you access to a bunch of free public APIs that you can use to extract a lot of data. A lot of times in your job, you'll be needed to extract data from your API. I had a similar problem recently. So let's take an example of a random API here. One famous API is movie APIs. If you want to create a website like IMDb, you can do that with a bunch of open free data from this OMDB API. If you look at it, it's basically an HTTP API. You can define a bunch of parameters and it'll give you a response. The response will be a bunch of movies that you asked for. For example, if I search for a movie that starts with school, it'll give me a bunch of movies. It gave me this movie, which is titled School of Rock. And I can use this API to create an IMDb website of my own. Now, I had a similar use case where I had to hit an API and get back some data, and I used TypeScript in my workflow. Now, for those of you who don't know, think of TypeScript as a stronger version of JavaScript that lets you define types. Now, what are types? If you look at here, this is a very big JSON object, and you can tell what the shape of the data looks like. So it has a title field, a rated field, so on and so forth. When you're in TypeScript and you have to hit such an API, it's always good to have a type for the response that you're getting. And as you can see, the response here is huge. Before ChatGPT, I would have to manually type out this response one by one and create a TypeScript type. Now I can use ChatGPT to offload this task. Let me show you how. I go to chat.openai.com, and if I simply type, hey, can you give me the types, TS types for this object? That's it. It'll pretty much give me a type for this object, which I can simply reuse in my TypeScript code. Now, before ChatGPT, I would either have to rely on the developers of this open API to give me the type, or I would have to write it on my own. And it's very easy to fat finger when you're copy pasting such an ugly string and try to create its type on your own. But thanks to ChatGPT, thanks to a task that's very repetitive, very simple, and can be done by a machine, I can now do it. So these are things that probably should be done by machines, only there wasn't a structured way to do it before this. Now I can just ask it in a very simple fashion. I did not even write TypeScript, I wrote TS. and it understood it needs to give me a TypeScript type. So will this take my job away? Maybe, maybe not, I don't know. But for today, it has made my life much easier. Rather than worrying about whether or not it'll take my job, I'm happy I can outsource a task which is very repetitive, at least at the moment. And now I have the tools to outsource it to a mini intern of mine. If you look at the type that it returned here, it's a pretty complex type and it would have taken me at least 15 minutes to write this from this. But thanks to ChatGPT, it wrote it for me. Now, this is just step one. When I was interacting with that API, a lot of times APIs have clients. A client is basically an abstraction to hit this API. So let me just hit this API first so you understand what I'm doing here. So if I go to this URL, I've asked this API for a bunch of movies that have the title horror in it. I can also search for example, Harry, and it'll return me a movie that looks like basically Harry Potter. Now, in my Rust app or my Golang app or my Node.js app, I need to send a request to get back this response. I can probably ask ChatGPT to do it. What if I tell ChatGPT, hey, can you write code to hit this API? Let me just copy this and get back response that looks something like this. Use the type you defined above. I think it should be able to generate the code for me. That used to take me 5 to 10 minutes to write. Again, writing the type was the most difficult bit because that was manual and that was boring. And as an engineer, you don't want to spend your time doing that. Writing an HTTP call is not as difficult. It wouldn't take you as long. But if an AI can do it, why not use the AI to do it? So here, as you can see, it created a function for me. The function is called fetch movie data, which sends out an HTTP call to the OMDB API and gets back the response and returns the response, the type of the response being movie. Here you can see it made a function call and then logged the data. In fact, if I copy this whole thing and paste it in JS Fiddle, I think it'll just work. Let's confirm that. So after fiddling a bit on JS Fiddle, I realized something really dumb. I hope you got this before I did. But JS Fiddle has JS in the name. It cannot understand TypeScript. It can only understand JavaScript. So I'll have to go to a different compiler. You can either compile it on your own machine or use something like Replit. And here I think I can do TypeScript code. So let's create a new REPL and paste the code that we got here, run it. And I think now it should be able to get back the response. Let's see what it does. It gives me an error. It says cannot find module axios. Now I know what the solution is here, but you can always ask ChatGPT to fix this for you as well. I get the error. It says, it seems like you haven't installed the axios package. You can do that like this. So if I copy this code and I paste it here in the terminal, I think it should now work. I'll show you very quickly how I can like create open source projects like this. Now, thanks to ChatGPT, there are so many APIs out there that I can create very nice abstractions for, open source them, and I'm sure it'll help out a lot of people. So let's try to run this again. And now hopefully you get back a movie response. So here is when an error came, and here is when I feel you as a software developer trying to use ChatGPT might get frustrated. This, I think, is an error that ChatGPT might not be able to help you with. One, because it's happening on a third-party platform. I'm sure it'll get smarter over time. But right now, looking at this error, firstly, I don't think an AI or a human can understand this very well. I think this is a very internal error. We will debug this very soon. But the idea is, or my point is, this is like off topic from this video, but generally when you're programming, and let's say you're a complete noob at the moment, you might use ChatGPT to understand code or write such clients, but then when you get stuck at a point like this, you probably need a human to help you out. So if you're learning to program, I would at this point suggest you reach out and not just stop. It's easy to just stop coding at this moment because you see a big error and you don't know what's happening. You've done everything right. But at this point is when you need people. So feel free to join the Discord group and ask these questions. I'm sure someone can help you out. And now I will try to debug what the issue is here. I'm going to think out loud. I don't think ChatGPT can help me here. Let me paste the whole thing here and let's see what it says. Yeah, most probably, I think I could be wrong, but I think Replit doesn't let you hit internet APIs. That's my guess. I could be wrong. I think that's why it's basically blocking this HTTP request. And that's why we see 0.0.0.0 here versus what we should see. So this is where ChatGPT might not be able to help you. My guess most probably is that this code is backend code and hence is running on a Replit machine. And this Replit machine has either stopped all internet access or is not able to resolve this specific URL because of DNS issues. So a few solutions here are either running this on your machine locally, or a more elegant solution is if we just run this in a front-end project. Why is that elegant? It's elegant because we can still use Replit. We don't have to set it up locally. But at the same time, if I'm using front-end code, all network requests will go from my machine. And we already know network requests to the OpenDB API are working pretty well from my machine. So I can just put the code that I put in the TypeScript backend project here, maybe. Let me remove the imports and take them to the top. Let me add Axios as a library, and then let's try to run this in a front-end project. Again, as I said, this is where ChatGPT might not be able to help you because you're using an external provider. It may be able to tell you what's going on under the hood, but this is where experience helps a lot. And that's why I'm sort of bullish on engineers generally. It might not take our jobs because there are small nitty-gritties that it might not be able to understand, at least yet. Now, let's try to run this code and see if it works. Again, all this code to fetch the API was written by ChatGPT, so I haven't written it. I understand it, but I haven't written it. There's a compilation error here. Let me fix that real quick. So I've made the project completely empty. I'm going to paste the code again. I'm going to move this import to the very top, and I'm going to try to compile it now. It does run correctly, and if I go to my console, I should hopefully see the movie object. So as you can see, I got the Harry Potter movie object. I see it twice. If you can tell me why, that'd be great. Let me know in the comments. But basically, I logged the movie object here and I got it in the console, which means if I search for Harry Potter, which I did here, if I search for something else, I'll get the response for that specific movie. But it works well. This code that ChatGPT gave me is able to hit an API, get back the response. Now, usually when you're working in the industry, you're hitting these API endpoints, you don't want this exposed in your code anywhere. So you create clients. What are clients? Clients are basically sort of abstractions around this code, classes that you create to abstract all this API calling logic into a class. So let's try to see if ChatGPT can do that. Can you create a TypeScript client for these APIs? Question mark. I think it should be able to. There you go. It says, here's a TypeScript client for the OMDB API. So as you can see, it also like is able to figure out a lot of things on its own. For example, that this is the OMDB API. Probably can figure out that this is used for movies. It was able to itself give it a very nice class name. And hence, like, this is actually pretty smart. It's created, like, extracted out a base URL string, which it knows it's a URL, and it's probably good to abstract that out into a different variable. So it's pretty smart that way. It created a search movie function, and it created a search movie detail function. It somehow already knows this API completely. I only gave it one endpoint. It was able to create the other function for me as well. Gave me a very nice client class that I can use in my final project. Hence, these are things I used to write by hand before this. Every API, unless the API has given a client like this themselves, you have to sort of write it on your own. Now, with the power of ChatGPT, you can automate it. But I personally feel if you've written it at least once by on your own, you'll be much smarter and much better to use this tool versus like copying, pasting from the beginning. For example, I don't know Ruby on Rails very well. Let's ask it, hey, can you create a similar client in Ruby on Rails? I'm sure it'll give me the code, but I don't understand it. I don't know where to put it. I don't know how to put it. I don't know how to use it. So strong suggestion here is to first understand how to write these things on your own and then use it as your intern to offload tasks when you're good at them. Cool. These were the two things I wanted to share as to how it has helped me. As you can see, it helps me with tasks that I already understand. I know can be automated, and I use it to automate those tasks. I always also make sure I don't paste any of my internal company code here. You shouldn't do that. And one last thing I wanted to share, another sort of common use case for me is to use it to fetch data. For example, recently I wanted to make an input box. In the input box, the user can put their phone number and select what country they're in. It'll give them a prefix of their country code. Now, for me to fetch all of this data from the internet and then convert it into a specific schema, specific type is hard, but I can just ask ChatGPT to do it. Hey, can you give me an array of countries, phone number, code in TypeScript? I think it'll just generate it for me. So these are the other set of things I use it for. This is a task that in big companies might just be the task of a different team. So you assign it to a different team. But now, thanks to ChatGPT, it's able to poll the internet and give you a very nice object. As you can see, it created a type itself for this country object and is able to fetch all the data from the internet and give me this object that I can put in my input box. So this is another place where I feel it's super helpful to scrape the internet for data and make the job of a software engineer much easier. Writing this, scraping this from the internet shouldn't be the job of an engineer. And hence, you now have a mini intern to do it. So these are the three things, the three ways I use ChatGPT today. If you are a complete beginner though, these might not be too relevant here. As I said, you should first understand how you can write these things by yourself and only then use ChatGPT to automate your tasks. Else what will happen is something commonly known as imposter syndrome, where you can do things, you can maybe even join a company, but over there you'll feel like an imposter. You'll feel like you don't really understand things. When people talk about technologies, you might not be able to answer it well, because, well, you don't have ChatGPT at all times, like translating what people are talking about. So strong suggestion here, in fact, very, very strong preference for you to write these things on your own and then use it as a mini intern versus using it from the beginning. I think that's really bad. As you can see, it created a Ruby on Rails client for me, but I pretty much don't know how to use it. I now understand it a little bit because I've written HTTP clients in various languages, but still I would first want to create a class like this on my own and then use ChatGPT for it. Now, what to do if you're a beginner? I recently created a full stack roadmap and I gave out a full stack roadmap assignment. I feel ChatGPT might be able to just complete it on its own. The assignment was to create a basic backend for a project, and then basically all the code is here and I've added a bunch of comments on what to do. I think if I copy this code and paste it in ChatGPT, tell it, hey, can you complete this? It'll pretty much complete this code for me. But should you do it? Probably not. In the video also, I explained the right way to use ChatGPT as a student is to ask it small questions so that you can understand things. You could always paste the whole code here and I'm sure it'll give you the answer, but it's not the best way for you to learn. What you should have done instead is started from the first comment. Add logic to decode body. So the question should be, how can you decode body? Or even before that, like, what exactly is body inside app.post? And it'll tell you, hey, it's the HTTP parameter. Okay, what's HTTP? Ask such smart questions so you understand things from the fundamentals. Your career is extremely long. You don't want to use a machine so that you don't have to understand fundamentals, because eventually those are what you need. I sort of feel happy that I got to spend 5 years in the industry without AI, because now I've dived deeper into various things. I've chewed a lot of glass, and hence I understand these things from the fundamentals. I can always use ChatGPT to offload tasks, but I myself also understand what's happening. Might totally happen that the code that it's giving us here is not the right code. And if that happens, you really need to clean it up. You need to be the one who cleans it up. And hence you need to have your fundamentals strong. So ask ChatGPT the right questions. Use it as a mentor and not as a slave. If you use it as a slave, it might enslave you eventually. Let's look at the code that it's written. So there is a signup function that looks right. It returns a 409 status code if the user with this email already exists. Else it returns the user registered successfully. The login function that lets you log in. If you log in correctly, it returns you a random token. If you ask for questions, it gives you all the questions. If you ask for submissions, it gives you all the submissions. This is actually wrong. Actually, I'm going to paste this gist. Link is in the description. Go through this code yourself and try to understand what are the things that are wrong here. I will explain them as well, but like, try to do it yourself and then come back to the video. What's wrong here is you need the submissions only for a user. You don't want this API endpoint to expose all submissions, else you'll be able to see submissions of your friend, which is not something you want. And post submission sort of looks okay, but you should probably store the user ID here so that you can fetch it correctly in this endpoint. So not bad, actually pretty good, but I would use it as a starting point and not the end goal for my projects or for my clients, wherever I'm using it. Most probably, if you're a student right now trying to understand code, use it as a mentor and ask it very nice, specific, small questions so you understand the language, and by the end of it, you can write everything yourself. Then use it as an intern. Hopefully, my point here was put forward correctly. It is extremely powerful. It does help software developers a lot, and I, as a senior engineer, am using it effectively, but make sure it doesn't enslave you, and it'll happen if you try to enslave it. With that, let's end the video. I'll see you guys in the next one. Bye.